very happy Father's Day to you. I hope you're having a great weekend. Now, we've all seen the pictures by now, I think, of last weekend as a storm, significant, powerful storm slammed into southern Alberta. And we're told that the cost of the damage could reach up to $1 billion. It was very significant. Last Saturday night, I was just kind of settling in for a very quiet evening, and I got a text message from our oldest son. He shared with me the alert that he had just received about a tornado warning in the region, and his comment was simply, "We could be in for some fun." Well, it was not fun, and it was devastating. Thankfully, many people in Lethbridge and other communities escaped some of the damage, but it takes quite the resilience to weather out difficult storms. And that's what we see in the life of Nehemiah. We're trying to take cues from his example about how he persevered in service for God. How did he do that? How did he weather some of these significant storms? Herbert Lockyer writes about Nehemiah this: "Prayer was the maintained attitude and constant habit of Nehemiah. He prayed all the time, all the way through, and about everything, and he prospered because he prayed." Now, of course, we don't want to be blind to the fact that Nehemiah is a record for us in the scripture of the rebuilding of the walls of Jerusalem. It's a significant component of this book. But I think that the prayer of depending upon God, trusting God, relying upon God, is perhaps an even greater expression for this book. And that is what we're looking at. Over the next weeks, we're continuing to survey the 8 prayers that are found in the book of Nehemiah. We're calling this series Recalculating. You know, when you hit a detour and the GPS tells you we're recalculating. And so we're thinking about what it means to adjust to life's detours and to have a dependence upon God in those times, at all times. And today we're going to look at 2 prayers in chapter 4 of Nehemiah. Now, by all accounts, Nehemiah was doing very well in his profession. He was an attendant in the royal court. He would not have stayed in that role unless he had been very successful and the king was very pleased with his performance. But he faced a dramatic detour. Having heard a report of the devastation in Jerusalem, Nehemiah was responsive to the call of God on his life to go back to Jerusalem and to help and guide and lead in the restoration of the city, particularly the walls surrounding the city. But just before we examine the storm that he encountered, remember we saw last week, just by arriving in Jerusalem, opposition was stirred up. But before we see that, let's just think a little bit about where we are in the progress of the story. We're deliberately skipping over chapter 3, which tells us about the beginning of the building project. We're simply not looking at chapter 3 in any detail because we want to focus on the prayers, and chapter 3 doesn't contain a prayer. But let me just make a couple of comments, because it's a wonderful passage giving us some of the richest description of the topography and geography of Jerusalem itself. I'm going to refer you back to the map that I showed you last week. And as you look to the top of the map, you will see the Sheep Gate. And chapter 3, just interestingly, starts with the description of the rebuilding of the Sheep Gate. And then it moves to what would be your left as you're looking at the map. It goes in a counterclockwise direction, working its way around, describing the rebuilding of 10 gates. Now, don't be discouraged if you're thinking about God's eternal purposes for Jerusalem, because there are 2 more gates mentioned in chapter 12. You may be thinking already about the book of Revelation, particularly Revelation 21, that describes the 12 gates of Jerusalem. I think what was really significant about how this project unfolded was the way that people worked next to one another. Now, that little phrase, next to, is found over 2 dozen times in chapter 3. And it's significant because we're talking about the synergy of the collective effort of the households of Israel as they gathered together under Nehemiah's leadership, and they sought to restore honor to God by rebuilding the walls of Jerusalem, by restoring the integrity of the city, which was a picture, which was a display of God's gracious dealing with his people. However, as it happens so often, whenever we undertake great work for God, there will be great opposition. And this opposition, which began already even before Nehemiah announced to the people of Jerusalem that his plan was to rebuild, already there was opposition, but now it ramps up much more significantly. And so I want to share with you two storms that Nehemiah faced. So first of all, Nehemiah faced a storm of intimidation. Perhaps you're feeling intimidated in some way today. He faced a storm of intimidation, and we pick up the story at Nehemiah chapter 4 and verse 1. When Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, he became angry and was greatly incensed. He ridiculed the Jews, and in the presence of his associates and the army of Samaria, he said, "What are those feeble Jews doing? Will they restore their wall? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they finish in a day? Can they bring the stones back to life from those heaps of rubble, burned as they are?" Tobiah the Ammonite, who was at his side, said, "What they are building, even if a fox climbed up on it, he would break down their walls of stones." Then Nehemiah prayed, "Hear us, O our God, for we are despised. Turn their insults back on their own heads. Give them over as plunder in a land of captivity. Do not cover up their guilt or blot out their sins from your sight, for they have thrown insults in the face of the builders." So we rebuilt the wall till all of it reached half its height, for the people worked with all their heart. Nehemiah had already a huge detour from his life of prestige in Persia, and now as he's in Jerusalem ready to undertake this great work for God, he faces another storm of opposition. You know, what was the source of this intimidating opposition that was coming against Nehemiah? Well, we've already been introduced to two characters in chapter 2, verse 10. Sanballat was from the town of Beth Horon. It was just a little bit to the northwest of Jerusalem. And so he was called the Horonite, as one from Bet Horan, the house of Horan. And then there was also Tobiah, who's described as an Ammonite, obviously coming from the region of Ammon. Well, it's now the country of Jordan, just east of the Jordan River and the Dead Sea in Jerusalem, near Jerusalem. These men likely had political aspirations of some sort. There was some agenda that they had that would stir up their anger and frustration when Nehemiah appeared and began to bring order and structure to Jerusalem. It was in the interest of Sanballat and of Tobiah that Jerusalem would not be rebuilt. I thought, as I was reflecting on these men, I thought of the Pharisees. The Pharisees also were so self-absorbed that even when the creator of the universe stood before them in the person of Jesus Christ, they could not embrace his message. They were wrapped up in their petty political religious aspirations. And this is what will happen as we seek to serve God. There will be people who, whether like the Pharisees or like Sanballat and Tobiah, they're like putty, just like putty in the hands of our enemy Satan. And he knows he can use them to sow seeds of intimidation. Then we start to think, did God really call me? When we start to suffer from an acute case of self-doubt and discouragement, being disillusioned, is this really how my service for God is supposed to unfold? So we see a very discouraging source of intimidation, but how do we survive it? Well, again, we're trying to take some cues from the example that God has provided in the life of Nehemiah. And at verse 4, we discover a prayer. Verse 4 and 5 actually is an imprecatory prayer. That's kind of a technical term that's talking about a prayer that is asking God, get him. Asking God to be holding one's enemies and actually God's enemies accountable. So this prayer that Nehemiah expresses, much more than being vindictive and angry, really it's coming from his passion for God's glory. He's asking God to maintain his glory in the face of these attackers. This kind of prayer simply seeks that God would hold our intimidators accountable. And it's a great example of dependence upon God, allowing God to silence our enemies. Notice the way that Nehemiah doesn't appear to engage with his intimidators. He seeks God alone to deal with them. The work continued in verse 6. That's a great indication that Nehemiah left the task of justice with God, and he focused on the task that God had given him. The people could not have returned to the task with such energy. It says here they worked with all of their heart. They could not have done that had they not, under Nehemiah's example and leadership, left the problem of their intimidators with God. You know, the Israelites often faced impossible odds, but at every turn, the answer was the same: complete trust and dependence upon God. Think of one notable example, perhaps the pinnacle of God's deliverance of the people, bringing them through the Red Sea. But before the waters opened for them to escape, they were pinned between the sea and the advancing Egyptian army. And at that point, Moses announced a call upon them that was profound. Exodus 14, 13 and 14 says that Moses said this: "Do not be afraid, stand firm, and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you. You only need to be still." Now, I wonder if there's something in your life today that is a source of great intimidation, stress, difficulty. Perhaps there is some perfect storm that has brewed around you and you are facing some form of intimidation. We need to follow the advice that Moses gave the people of Israel. Stand firm, trust God, give it over to him. Maybe even voice in some detail to God through prayer that you long for his glory, you long for him to hold enemies of the kingdom of God accountable. Well, there's another storm that Nehemiah faced. We just have gone half a dozen verses into chapter 4, but the rest of the chapter I'm grouping together in what I'll call a storm of insecurity. That we find in verses 7 through 23. And I'm going to just read a few verses as we go through and explain a little bit. This is a storm of insecurity. You know, storms on land are bad enough. What about storms at sea? You know, no thank you. I don't really enjoy a threatening storm when I'm on terra firma. What if I'm on the ocean? That would be quite intimidating. The 18th century English author Samuel Johnson put it this way: being in a ship is like being in jail with the chance of being drowned besides. The legendary surfer Buzzy Trent said, "Waves are not measured in feet or inches. They are measured in increments of fear." I don't know what the increments of fear are in your particular experience today, but we can say fearing the storms and the angry waves, that's not limited to the ocean or to the land. It's in our lives as we try to follow Jesus. And we realize just how vulnerable we are when we get into those circumstances. This is what happened in Nehemiah's case, and it happens in our lives today. There will always be the Sanballats and the Tobias that are angry, bitter, jealous, and they express that in acts of intimidation, in acts that try to take away our security in Christ. Think of the storm that there was coming at them. Let me pick it up at verse 7 and 8. But when Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, the Ammonites, and the men of Ashdod heard that the repairs to Jerusalem's walls had gone ahead and that the gaps were being closed, they were very angry. They all plotted together to come and fight against Jerusalem and stir up trouble against it. Now, not only was there Sanballat and Tobiah, but the anger and the bitterness against the people of Jerusalem and Nehemiah bound together more people. The Arabs, as they're described here, men that are now coming from Ashdod, and unified in their anger at the rebuilding, they plotted to fight against Jerusalem. But Nehemiah remained focused, even in the face of fear and danger. Now, today, there are many, many followers of Jesus who are suffering physical harm and violence and insecurity in a very real way simply because they love Jesus and follow him. That's around the world, but for sure in our own specific community and experience, you know, that's probably not the case where we're experiencing physical harm for our faith. I'm often reminded of the fact that this is even mentioned to the people in Hebrews in chapter 12, verse 4. In your struggle against sin, you've not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. It's an honest admission from the writer to all of these Hebrews that were scattered in the first century. Okay, we understand. You're not necessarily physically harmed for your faith, but you're still facing great insecurity. Satan is constantly stirring up storms of opposition against those who would follow the Lord Jesus. Jesus pledged that would be the case. So we find Nehemiah's response in verse 9. And notice how it's worded. But we prayed to our God and posted a guard day and night to meet this threat. Now, just like we saw in chapter 2, we don't really have the content of Nehemiah's prayer. We might surmise or guess based on his life and testimony and practice of prayer throughout the book. We don't, though, have the content, but I think what we see is his commitment that whenever there was an issue, his first response was prayer. He always looked to God. And notice also in verse 9, it does indicate we prayed. I take that to suggest that Nehemiah's example had started to rub off on the people. And you know, it's a wonderful byproduct of prayer. As you live in prayerful trust and dependence upon God, it will inspire others to do so as well. Now, it's not to say that the threat didn't exist just because Nehemiah prayed. The threat didn't cease immediately. In fact, Nehemiah recognized that there was both the opportunity to trust God, but also to be diligent and prepare for the danger that was there. We're not going to be immune to fear or discouragement. If we were to look down, and encourage you to read down into verses 10 through 12, the people were starting to waver and wonder if they were going to be able to keep this project moving forward. So it does present to us a bit of a tension. And I'm just going to skip now down to verses 16 through 20 and think about this unique tension that comes out at this time. Because earlier, I suggested to you Moses' encouragement to the people was stand still, don't move. Well, in fact, they did move at the right time when God said, now move through the deliverance of the waves and waters parted of the Red Sea. But let's read Nehemiah's experience. at verse 16. From that day on, half of my men did the work, while the other half were equipped with spears, shields, bows, and armor. The officers posted themselves behind all the people of Judah who were building the wall. Those who carried materials did their work with one hand and held a weapon in the other. And each of the builders wore his sword at his side as he worked. But the man who sounded the trumpet stayed with me. And I said to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people, the work is extensive and spread out, and we're widely separated from each other along the wall. Whenever you hear the sound of the trumpet, join us there. Our God will fight for us. Now, does the fact that the people worked, but they also weaponized, does that suggest that they were living in fear? I'm certain there were some people who were willing to work, but maybe not completely trusting the Lord. But overall, the example seems to be that they worked because they trusted in God. They moved forward because they believed he would protect them. In fact, Nehemiah says, God will fight for us. And so the fact that they were both working, but also prepared for an attack, suggests to us, I think, this is a matter of diligence. And really, it is an expression of their dependence upon God. In the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus invited his followers to watch and pray. Watch and pray. And it's a unique tension in which we are to continue to move forward in the work that God has given us to do, but we're to do it in a prayerful, dependent manner. I think that is what Nehemiah displays for us. He didn't end verse 20 in the middle. When we have to fight, let's fight. He said, when we have to fight, God will fight for us. Herbert Locke here put it this way. Nehemiah knew God would protect him, but he was careful to add a sword to the equipment used to build the wall. He trusted God, but kept his powder dry. Dependence upon God alone will win the day. But you know, the unique tension is, and really the exciting adventure, is that he invites us into the process. And we find this in Romans 8, verse 37, where we can be completely dependent upon God. But we're told, as we walk in Christ, when you have a relationship with Jesus, if you are a follower of Christ, then what is the promise? We will be more than overcomers. Now, the word is pretty cool. It is the word where we get the English word hyper, something that's above and beyond. And then also the word Nike, or you might be wearing some Nike shoes right now, and it's the Greek word for victory. So what is Paul saying to the Romans? If you're in Christ, if you're a follower of Jesus, because of him, you are actually a super victor. This is the promise. And the fact that we move forward and we continue to work and we're diligent to watch for the difficulties that are coming against us can also be an expression of our dependence. Well, I really encourage you to visit Digging Deeper, and if you want to review these notes and get a few more ideas for further exploration. You know, wall building is a political hot potato south of the border. We all are aware of that. But building the walls of Jerusalem had bigger implications than political or racial or even military. As the walls of the city of Jerusalem grew, the restoration of the space where God would be worshiped and glorified and revealed to the world was being renewed. And the renewal and revival that was going on in Jerusalem was so that people could once again see God's gracious dealings with his chosen ones. So where are the storms of opposition coming against you or I today? Obviously, COVID-19 is a storm in which a lot of things are being stirred up: fear, anxiety, uncertainty. And in time, we are believing God that we'll be meeting together again. when we will be in a large group in the rental of a school facility, that looks to be a number of months away. But as a leadership team, we're prayerfully discerning a strategy where we can gather in smaller groupings in homes, and we're going to have the opportunity to renew fellowship, renew ministry one to another, but even serving together in our community. And we're going to be able to explore God's word together, maybe in a more interactive way than we've been used to. Here are four questions, that just some examples of some sample questions and some sample action steps that we'll be putting in front of you in the days ahead. Read these. Maybe you won't even give these a whirl today. I encourage you to think and prayerfully prepare for how we're going to start, well, we might say rebuilding the walls of our fellowshipping and connecting and worshiping together. God bless you today.